So, good afternoon. I'm going to be discussing questions proposed by various people, participants. By the way, I'm Parameswaran Sankaran. I'm a faculty member in this institute. There were many different types of questions touching so many different topics. Initially, I thought I was going to play just the role of a mediator so I can pass on questions to other people who can answer, but I will still do that. I will take help from my colleagues here who have already talked about some of the questions raised here. So let me just start with one thing I would like to say is I don't want to dwell too much on any one particular question. In order for this discussion session to be effective, we will just not spend too much time on a minor point, okay? So if it means that you are not convinced about the answer, that could we can give references where you may find greater detail so that most people are benefited and we have time to discuss as many questions as possible, okay? Okay, let me begin with this following question. How to explain scalar product graphically and also vector product? Did you talk about that, discuss that, Raghavan? Scalar product and vector product graphically. Okay, so. So what is scalar product? You suppose A and B are two vectors. A, we don't usually bother to put the arrow mark and so on. It's understood for vectors. So A dot B. So you can define this to be length of A, length of B times cos theta. Well, that's just a definition where theta is the angle between A and B. Angle between A and B. But you should imagine, so suppose for a minute that A is a unit vector, okay? Suppose. So I didn't mean to write full sentences. So suppose A is a unit vector, then you can represent in picture what this A dot B would be. Suppose B is this and A is this, it's just a unit length. Then A dot B, as you all know, you just drop the perpendicular from this, having ensured that both these vectors emanate from a common point, just project this point to this line. This, if this angle theta is acute, then this distance, so this is the foot of the perpendicular of the point P, this is unit vector, is O, OP is the scalar product or represents a length of OP, represents the scalar product. Okay. Of course, if the angle is obtuse, then A is pointing this way, but you are getting OP, therefore put a negative sign. Okay. That's what it represents. What if A is not the unit length? A can be length 100, for example. Then you just magnify whatever this OP is by that amount, by the length of A, okay? Then you get some quantity, and that is what graphically dot product is, okay? So, and what about scalar product? Vector triple product, that also many of you know, so I'm just just want to say, suppose A is this vector and B is another vector, and you look at the angle from A to B, suppose is theta, okay, then okay, so you just complete this to be a parallelogram. So graphically, I suppose this is the way I would interpret the word graphically. A cross B is a the vector whose length is the area of the parallelogram. Represented above, and well, it's a vector quantity, so there is also a direction. So and points to, so I'll just say positive normal, positive unit normal. To the plane of AB, plane spanned by A and B. Of course, what if A and B don't span a plane? It only has some span. They are multiples of each other. Then you don't get a plane. In that case, A cross B is zero. Okay. So, and then what does it mean to say positive orientation? You have to look at positive normal. I'll just say it very quickly. So A, so you have, so let's call this vector U or something. Then what you would like to say is A, B and U form a positive system if, okay, is this definition in terms of left-handed screw, right-handed screw? I was weak in physics. I never can understand. I mean, why left-handed, right-handed? Can we not talk about something invariant under whether somebody is handed or not? I mean, write it in terms of ijk, then form the determinant with rows, first row coming from coordinates of A, second row coordinates of B, third row coordinates of U, that should be positive determinant. That's of course, I already said that points are normal, that means A is perpendicular, U is perpendicular to the plane of A and B, I already said that. Then U is determined up to sine, the sine is determined by requiring that the determinant must be positive. Okay. That determines U, so that is the geometric representation. So just determine like that. Okay. Feel free to ask me questions if some things are still not clear. Next, I want to discuss. Can I go on? Okay. So. Yeah.
A cross B and A dot B.
Yeah. So A dot B is only a scalar. It's just the answer is just a number.
The length in the sense the projection falling on the.
Yeah. So if A is the unit vector, A has length 1, then you just look at the line generated by this. That is, look at the line on which this A lies. Okay. Everything can be brought to the origin. Now project this tip of the vector B to this line, meaning just take an orthogonal projection. This line is perpendicular. Then this side is what represents the scalar product. Okay. So because this is theta, what is length of OB? That is just B. Okay. If this is theta, cos theta times B, so B is now playing the role of hypotenuse, cos theta times B is just OP. So you get the formal definition also this way. So geometrically it represents just projection. Okay, so in particular, if this vector OB was perpendicular to A, then of course it's like looking at the shadow. So just put a light at infinity, just look at the shadow of this vector, that vector will be this, and then look at the length of that vector. If this is perpendicular, the shadow will fall right on O itself, then the length is zero. Okay, so here, well, you have sine theta. Okay. Somebody asked, why cos theta, why not use sin theta there and cos theta here and so on. This is an obvious reason. Yeah, okay, that is the definition, but why first of all define A dot B to be AB cos theta? Why not define A dot B to be AB sin theta? What goes wrong? I would like to say just one line. You would like A dot A to be square of the length of A, okay? Then you play with this. See, if A equals B, then A dot A has to be norm A square. That means, but then angle between A and A is zero, so cos zero is one. If you had in the formula sine theta or tan theta or something else, it would not work out right. You would like A dot A to be length of A square. So, okay, that's why you would like this. Here, why do you want to have sine theta there? I suppose there had been lot of discussion about how to define cross product in terms of ijk and so on. We would like, whatever definition you use, we would like I cross j to be equal to k. All right? So, I cross j, what should be the magnitude? You would like it to have magnitude same as magnitude of k, and that means 1, and if you are going to get 1, cos theta won't work, because theta, if A is I and B is J, angle between them is 90 degrees, you put cos 90, you will get 0. You have to have sin theta. Okay, well, this is this is just a rationale why it is the way it should be, cannot give any further explanation. We have to go back to the definition and then it's clear. But why define it this way? This is the rationale behind it. This is the way to understand it. Okay? It's the way I understand it rather. Maybe there are other ways of it. Let me see if there are any more questions about vectors. I don't see any more questions about vectors. There have been many questions about function concepts and so on. So one participant wanted to know y equal to, if you look at y equal to x cube, why is it increasing? Okay, why is it strictly increasing? Okay, so I suppose that person had in mind, if you look at the derivative, that becomes, y dash becomes 3x square and it vanishes. So, is it correct to say it is increasing, or is it correct to, not so correct to say it's increasing because y dash vanishes? But go back to the definition, what does it mean to say it's increasing or strictly increasing? Strictly increasing means, if A is less than B, f of A must be less than f of B. That condition is satisfied here. Okay? Derivative vanishing only says, means in this case, that, so this is x axis, the y axis. Derivative vanishing only tells you that there is a horizontal tangent. So the tangent here, this x-axis becomes a tangent. Of course, you all know how the graph is going to look like. It's going to look like this. Sort of the curve crosses the x-axis. Okay? It goes like this, becomes tangential, and then it again increases. Okay? And so there is no contradiction of any kind. Is that clear? So just because derivative vanishing derivative vanishes, you cannot say the function is not increasing or decreasing or anything like that. Okay, you can look at somebody wanted to know about second derivative test. Why does it work? Why second derivative must be negative at a maximum, a local maximum, and so on? I want to say something about that. I'm not going to write down the explicit function, but just in terms of picture, you can explain. So, suppose you have a diagram looking like that. Also looks like graph of a cubic curve, but doesn't matter. Maybe something. So, this is the graph of some curve. Some function y equals fx, and you can see that there is a local maximum here, local minimum, and then again some local maximum somewhere here, maybe here, and then again, and so on. Okay, now so if you look at the picture. So pictorially, let me say, pictorially, how do we understand second derivative test or second derivative? Okay, what is second derivative telling you, assuming function is twice differentiable and so on? So you draw a graph of the function and take any point, not necessarily a local maximum or something, but just any point, and draw a tangent on it, maybe. Okay, somewhere here. Now, the second derivative tells you whether part of the graph close to the point of tangency is above or below, okay, the tangent. Alright, for example, at a local, at this point, it is actually below. At this point, it is looking like it is to the right, okay, and now you look at this point. At this point, it's above. At this point, it's above. At this point, it's above. But somewhere or other, suddenly you will see it has to see it, at this point it's above. At this point, it's the curve is below, somewhere it will have to cross. There will be a tangent where if I magnify it, it becomes, see, I draw the tangent first because, and then it has to go like that. There it crosses, okay? So what does it tell you? What second derivative tells you is the rate at which the slope of the tangent changes. After all, slope is given by first derivative, which is rate at which the function is changing. Therefore, it stands to reason that the second derivative should tell you rate at which the slope is changing. Now here, the slope is positive and positive, but then it becomes smaller. See, it is more slanted. And it is even more slanted. But when it comes here, it even becomes horizontal. Okay? That means near this point, okay, the slope is decreasing. Okay? That means second derivative is negative. Okay? And as you come here, it's even more negative. It is now, slope itself is negative. From 0, it has become negative, decreasing, and somewhere along here, the graph crosses the tangent line. So it's like this, near here somewhere. So that's the point of what we call point of inflection, and there, at the point of inflection, second derivative vanishes, okay? Because it changes from decreasing nature to increasing nature. From then on, it's going to be increasing. And here, when you hit a local minimum, positive, after, see, and then goes on like this. Okay. So this is the explanation for second derivative, geometric interpretation or meaning of second derivative. Yes.
So should the quantum condition also have the first derivative zero?
Yeah. So, okay. True. So the, what I said was where the curve crosses the tangent line becomes a point of inflection.
So there will be any two local minima and maximum.
There will have to be. There will have to be. That is a consequence of intermediate value theorem. Here the second derivative was negative. Here second derivative is positive, as you can see. But if the second derivative is continuous, somewhere or other it has to vanish. And that means that there is some tangent line where curve changes the position from left to right or right to left. Okay. So this is the geometric meaning or interpretation of second derivative.
Is there any connection between the acceleration and the second derivative?
If you think of point this space-time curve, second derivative is the acceleration.
So the acceleration gets negative, then you will get the function is positive.
No, function being positive or negative has nothing to do with second derivative, because the function, I mean the curve could have been like this. The x-axis I could have drawn here, then the whole thing is negative. Function, whether it is positive or negative, has nothing to do with that. The first of all, okay, you have function and then derivative. Okay, derivative. Whether it is positive or negative, that will depend on whether the function is increasing or decreasing. Just the same way, look at the acceleration or second derivative. Second derivative, whether it is positive or negative, would depend on whether the slope of the tangent is increasing or decreasing. And as we saw, near a maximum, see near a local maximum, you draw a picture like this and see what happens. The tangent is rather steep here, and as you approach local maximum, it becomes a little more slanted, and here in fact it becomes horizontal, and then it becomes slanted in the negative direction and goes on like this. That is why at this point, that is how you see that second derivative has to be negative near a local maximum. And just the opposite phenomenon happens near local minimum. Okay? So somebody asks how to represent second derivative in a diagram. I don't know how to answer that question. How would you answer this question? I don't know. See, if you can represent a function by a graph, well, any function, okay, maybe complicated to draw, but never mind the actual problem of tracing the curve. But if you can draw for a function, why not draw it also for second derivative? It may be complicated, but it is possible. But I don't know whether I have understood the question properly. Okay? GeoGebra will definitely help doing that. So how to represent... If you can represent a function by a graph, you can also represent its second derivative by a graph. Why not? Yeah? So somebody asks how to represent second derivative by a graph. I don't fully understand. To the extent that I understood, this would be my response. Yeah. Still some more problems about graphs and so on. Okay, so what is the value of, this is one question. Any question? Yes? Okay. For that same graph, okay, so... But I don't know how to draw the graph except to say what the features of the graph would be. So that much I can say. So what Raghavan, my colleague, says is just take the same graph, same function. For that function, draw the graph of the derivative and the second derivative. Okay, so well, I only know certain features of the graph, but maybe I wouldn't venture to draw it. Okay. I would suggest the following. This is much more helpful, particularly when you want to teach students. Okay. And I have myself taught calculus long back, and I have used this. You draw the graph, maybe sketch it or something. Then you have to analyze. You have to find out where the function has local maximum, where the function has local minimum, and so on. And suppose it turns out that for some function, you compute the second derivative to be, let us say, x square plus 1 whole square times something, x times x minus 2 times, say, I don't know, cos x. Okay, the exact value, etc., totally irrelevant for the point I'm going to make. The thing is, so you want to know where the function is what we call concave up, concave down. So concave up, if it is like this, it's concave up, or like this, it's concave up, and concave down means like this. And this device, what I call sine diagram for f double prime, perhaps it's used in many textbooks here, but I don't know. So you find out, instead of drawing the graph, which may be complicated, but you find out the intervals where the function is positive, where the function vanishes, and so on. Okay. For example, if you are, let's just take the interval to be something like sine 0 to some pi or something. Okay. Now, look at the factor in the denominator. That's always positive. So sine is going to be determined by the things in the numerator. Now, x is, so let us take it to be between minus pi and pi, just for fun. So let us look at this factor. I mark important points, minus pi, and then pi. And there is also this 2, which is an important point. Okay. Now, after you plot where these are 0 and now the thing is, x, this factor is always positive to the left of 0. So this factor is going to be positive. And x minus 2, this factor is negative on this region. And x minus 2 is also negative. Okay. And cos x between 0 and minus pi. So I have to make another thing, minus pi by 2. Okay. So from minus pi by 2 to minus pi, cos is negative. So three negative factors. So this is negative. And then it becomes, in this case, it's do it quickly. So this is positive. And then it's negative here. But sometimes you have to be a little bit careful. There may be some factors which behave in some funny way. So then it's positive. Another pi by 2. Yeah, pi by 2 I missed out. Pi by 2 is 3 after 2. No, pi by 2 is before 2. So here it is positive. And that is negative again. So this is negative. Okay, fine, no problem. Okay, and now you know, so where the function is going to be concave up, concave down. So this type of information, you can just look at it from here and then deduce about f. Okay, so this, what I call sine diagram, is much more helpful in understanding the graph of the given function. Yeah. So another question concerns greatest integer function. Let's look at this. So, okay, what is the value of, this is a question that is asked, but I will interpret it suitably. So what's the value of this, what's the value of this, and it is given that it's greatest integer function. I suppose this question must have been prompted by the observation that the greatest integer function has discontinuities at integer points. So perhaps the person is thinking that k is an integer, and h is some small number. Is okay. Well, so probably we are interested to discuss continuity of the greatest integer function. So let's just say, okay, if you write like this, k plus h doesn't automatically mean h is positive. Okay, so we'll assume that h is positive and small. Okay, so, okay, fine. Let's just say h is small, less than 1. Then of course k being an integer, this is just k, and here this is k minus 1. Okay. And when h is equal to 0, both are equal to k. This is also k, that's also k. K minus 1, that is k minus 1 still. This is k. Okay. This is also k. This is also k when h is 0. Pardon me?
I have a question.
Yes.
Yeah, at the risk of contradicting what I said earlier, I'm a physics teacher. So I've never seen situations in physics where there is a discontinuity, sharp changes.
Yes, yes.
So I'm wondering, why would anybody define something like a step function? I think the graph is like a step, right? So nothing wrong in defining. That's why I said at the risk of
contradiction. Okay, no problem.
Not really look at the applications. But again, I'd be happy to know if they do something with it. I'm wondering what could have been.
See, okay, fine. I'm glad you asked this question. See, step functions are absolutely essential for analysis. So they help you to go from sets to functions. What do I mean by that? So suppose you give me a subset E of the real number, then to that I can associate a function which is what is called characteristic function of the set E. Function value is 1 if the point element belongs to E, otherwise it is 0. Now this type of function is what is needed to approximate, for example, continuous functions to compute integration. Like in the morning there was some demonstration about how to use rectangles to approximate area. So in that context, if you want to do integration theory, you really require step function. You cannot do without them. This would be my, my colleagues agree with me. So you have any other response? Please feel free. Sorry?
The tenses.
Yeah. Functions can be, approximated very well by step functions. Step functions arising from sets which are measurable. You must have studied that in analysis course long back. Okay, so step functions are absolutely important for analysis.
Are there any physical processes which close?
I tell you one for the thing. So they talk about impulsive force. So you have an object, suddenly I just hit it, I give a whack. So that thing, at that point in time, so before that, force applied is flat, 0. And then at the time of, giving this impulsive force, becomes increases. And then you can talk about, what is the energy and so on, make calculations. So definitely, even in physics, this notion of step function does arise. So it is an important concept, and it has a lot of applications both in mathematics and in other branches of science.
Well, even in that case, I think in practice it's only still a continuous function.
No, step function is not continuous.
Function by definition is not. I'm looking at real-life physical situations. I'm wondering, are there is nature towards a continuous behavior?
That is a philosophical question. I don't know whether nature.
Processes which
I don't think it is. First of all, to my understanding is that nature is not continuous. Nature is discrete. That's why you have this quantum mechanics. Okay, but let us not. It depends. You know, if you want to study certain phenomenon happening at a certain scale, then you can forget about quantum properties and just think of it as a classical object, and maybe things are continuous. But certain things definitely are not continuous. We know that. Yeah. So everywhere you will find the step functions coming, and there will be applications. Okay. So is there any? I suppose this is the question that a person had in mind when he or she asked about this. So, okay. So now let's move on. How to define direction ratios and direction cosines? I don't know what is the difficulty. So when you have a straight line, so this is concerning direction cosines. Cosine of I don't know what type of objects, but perhaps straight lines. I suppose that's what you have in mind, of a straight line. So if you are given an equation of a straight line in 3D as some x minus a, so let's not write x minus x naught by a is equal to y minus y naught by b is equal to z minus z naught by c, and maybe this is some parameter t or whatever. This is usually not. So you look at this, and then you say that direction cosines. So first of all, direction ratios. I would say just a triple A, B, C. If you want direction, I'll write this and then explain. Direction cosines. So you just write the same thing, except that you make this vector to be, you can think of it as a vector if you like. Or if you don't want to think of it as a vector, you just want to think of it as a triple of numbers, that's also fine. Then divide by length of the vector, which is a square plus b square plus c square. So, comma b divided by square root of a square plus b square plus c square, and c divided by same quantity, a square plus b square plus c square. So this is direction cosine, direction ratios, and I suppose you all know why they are called that. You all know that, right? See? Yeah, you can say it that way. I will say that if you just look at this straight line as in the vector notation, perhaps the explanation comes much easier. So I want to write R as x, y, z coordinates. You may write this also as xi plus yj plus zk. I prefer to write in this particular fashion. Then, so what this is saying is that, it's good to have this t there now, quite handy. This says that r, which is equal to xyz, is equal to x naught plus at, y naught plus bt, z naught plus ct as t varies. Okay? And this is same thing as saying, so this you just get by, you know, x minus x naught by a equal to t, therefore x is equal to x naught plus at and so on. So this you write as x naught, y naught, z naught. This is a point p naught through which the line passes, and then t times ABC. So this is your ratio. This is one, this is a vector which points to the direction of the straight line. So I want you to think of this as, you know, A, if you want to think of it, AI plus BJ plus CK, then I'm fine with it. And so let's call this vector, as maybe U or something. Okay? Now, so I draw this vector U. The straight line A is point, this U, vector U points to the direction of the straight line. Okay? So in three space, so this vector U is here. If the vector U is here, this straight line is parallel to this. That's what it is. This expression tells you. Okay? Now, that is the reason why this is called direction ratios. Whether you like to, see, what's the significance of direction cosines? That is just to make the vector U unit vector. So you divide by the length. And then what is the reason for calling it cosine? That's because if you remember, U dot I is what? U dot I is A. If U is a unit, so we want to make U unit vector, okay? So I just want to write U by U, mod U. This is A dot, A times 1 times cos gamma 1, or I don't know what you call, cos gamma 1, where gamma 1 is the angle between I and the vector this, okay? So now cos gamma 1 comes in. Similarly, cos gamma 2, where gamma 2 is the angle that the vector makes with the j axis or y axis and so on. That's why cosines. That's the explanation for the word direction cosines. I hope this helps. Okay. So the reason why it is called direction ratios, direction cosines, comes from the fact that the vector, when you think of ABC as determining a vector, the straight line is parallel to that vector. So the straight line points to the direction of U. Okay?
So, how much more time do we have? 1.5 Okay. Yes.
You have some comment to make, Raghavan?
Okay.
The direction cosine is plus or minus.
Ah, yes. Okay, so that is just a matter of whether you take U pointing this direction or pointing that direction, you cannot determine it by looking at the straight line. For you, the straight line is important. So whether it is pointing to east or west, that's only two options that you just ignore. Anyway, you are going to look at the full straight line, not just pointing only to the positive direction. So really doesn't matter. If U is going to be 1, then minus U also will have the same property, so it's okay. That's the only ambiguity we'll have.
Specifically talking about straight line, plus or minus can be a lot of property. So vector probably we should be very particular in the meeting of the same.
Yeah, so, absolutely. But you know, when you write like this, so A, B, C are determined. Of course, you can write the same equation as minus A minus B minus C. Then my vector will be minus A minus B minus C.
Both this one, same.
Yeah.
Either plus sign or minus sign.
Yeah, of course. You cannot have just A, just change the sign of A, but not for the B, you should not do. Of course not. Absolutely. Okay. Several questions had been repeated, so.
Just 4 meter per second square.
4 meter per second square. So it's just a scalar, that's it. So somebody wants to know whether empty set is a proper subset or improper subset. I mean, it's just a matter of convention. I will say empty set is a subset of any set, okay? I would say just don't be disturbed by this terminology, proper subset, improper subset, who cares, just a subset, that's it. Okay. I think one should not worry too much about it. Of course, the students will have to pass exam, and then for them it may matter a lot because it carries one mark in the exam, but I'm not going to bother about that. Okay? You should tell students also not to bother too much about marks. Of course, marks are important for them, but you know, eventually it just doesn't matter at all. We all know it. So tell your students not to be too bothered about such things. Now I want to say, yeah, so as a sub, the same question, if you are given A to be set consisting of 1, 2, 3, then number of proper subsets of A, should it be 7 or 6 or 8 or what? I mean, 8 is not written here, but when you say proper, so then it becomes important whether you are going to count empty set or not. So depending on the convention, you give the answer. If you are going to tell your children, look, I will consider empty set, I will treat empty set on an equal footing as with other sets, okay? Then of course it is 7. The word proper usually is used for contained but not equal to. That is the sense in which it is used, okay? So if you adopt that convention, then why bother about, why should you be disturbed about empty set? It's like asking whether 0 is a natural number or not. I have seen textbooks where they say, we regard 0 as natural number. And there are any number of books which will say 0 is not a natural number. 0 must be a whole number. I mean, this type of hair splitting is absolutely irrelevant. And it's just a sheer waste of time. Tell your children that. In a classroom, you have to follow convention. And you stick to one convention. Like while driving, in India, we drive on the left side, okay? You go to America or some other country, many countries, they drive on the right side, okay? Stick to one convention, you will not go wrong.
So then why is it included? I mean, see, that being the case, they can simply throw the idea of null set being a subset.
No. It is extremely important to allow empty set to be a subset.
So there must be a reason for people saying it's a, let's forget about the terminology, this proper, improper, that I can understand the convention. But what could have been the reason for saying that subset, I mean null set should be a subset of a set? What could be the motivation?
What is wrong with saying empty set is a sub, empty set is a subset of every set, and therefore it is correct to say empty set is a subset. It may seem unnatural.
If a set has got 1, 2, 3 as objects, I understand 1 is in it, 2 is in it, 3 is in it. So, why do you take the trouble of saying...
Yeah, so that is where mathematicians differ from engineers and physicists. Okay? For mathematicians, it is extremely important to have empty set. It serves a certain purpose. If you throw away empty set, you will get into a lot of difficulties, and it is important to treat empty set very much like any other set. Okay?
For example, how to prove
it? That's a good question. I'll answer that question. So, if you want to say empty set is a subset, how do I prove it? Now, to prove that, what should I do? I will prove the contrapositive. Okay, let's assume that empty set is not a subset of a set A given to me. Okay, then what should I do? Actually, I should find an element in the empty set, but not in that given set. But there is no element. So, the claim is proved. Okay, that's it. So, it is, we can have our discussion during the coffee break. But I have other matters also to talk about. But take it from me, you have to have the empty set, you have to admit empty set among the collection of sets. If you don't do that, the language, see in mathematics there are conventions, language, And not only that, certain concepts become very complicated to state, very complicated to deal with. If you throw away empty set, if you don't want to treat empty set as a set, you will get into difficulty in expressing your ideas. In mathematics, we don't care about whether it occurs in nature, not occur in nature, whether it is, there is a certain way of doing things, and the nice way to do is to include this. Yeah? I don't think of it as an evil. It is not an evil. Is zero, anything wrong with zero? Why not include zero as natural number? For your convenience, you may follow certain conventions in the classroom. But you stick to some convention, fine. But don't say empty set is not a set, zero is not a number. I mean, so we have to know, you know, what is allowed, what is legal, what is not legal, and whether, see, there are, you know, certain choices that are given to you, but those choices you make judiciously. You can rebel against a certain convention, but then you will tie yourself in a knot sooner or later. Okay? So, try to follow convention. I'm sorry, I have...
I'm referring to the same point. I'm just trying to understand.
Okay.
I thought, for example, zero vector. I think when it comes to operating vectors, I think some closure requirement may be there.
Yes. Yes, of course.
I thought when you probably are going to operate some sets...
Yes, of course. Yes, absolutely. Okay, fine. So that is one example.
It's a definition. I think, correct me if I'm wrong, let's say that there is a set. I can perform some subset operations. I think when I perform operations among the subsets, I may need the null set has to be a subset.
Yes.
Am I correct?
Yes, absolutely. So you take a set consisting of three elements 1, 2, 3, you take the subset 1 consisting of 1, subset consisting of 2, you take the intersection. If you don't allow empty set to be a set, there is no meaning to this operation and you would like to attach a meaning, okay?
Even for identity element also.
Okay, so now we are diverging in a different direction and I want to bring back the focus to more concrete problems, okay? So, yeah, somebody wanted to know, yeah, this is an interesting question, I want to talk about that. This is equal to why write log mod x? So, okay. Once you know, you can just differentiate and compute. But you see, suppose you are doing definite integral. Okay? Integral, let us say, minus e to 1 by x. Dx minus 1. Then what should I do? So, this I should write as, so x is negative here, okay? Then I suppose I should write log minus x and then put minus e to minus 1. That becomes log of minus 1 log 1 minus log of minus of minus e, that is e. This is minus log e. There you don't put mod. Is this okay?
Modulus function is not differentiable.
Mod function may not be differentiable, but log mod x is differentiable. You see, you can have a function.
Integration is a converse of differentiation. It's log of mod x.
Yeah, so that's why, see. Okay, so mod x is not differentiable where? Only at origin. But log 0 is not defined. You throw away 0, then mod x is differentiable, okay? On r minus 0, log x is, mod x is differentiable, okay? So when you write log mod x, anyway, origin is, negative numbers themselves is not there, 0 is also not there in the domain of definition of log. So it is perfectly okay to write like that, okay? So, and you can have also different type of situation. A function may be not differentiable. Two functions may be there, f and g. F may be not differentiable. G may also be not differentiable. The composition may be differentiable. That's very much possible. Of course, you can cook up some weird function like that. But the point is, here it's even simpler explanation. Where mod x becomes non-differentiable, log is not even defined. So in the domain of the definition of log function, mod x is very much differentiable, and therefore composition of two differentiable function therefore done.
Log function is defined only for positive.
Yes, absolutely.
You need to use mod.
Yeah, so that's why, see, when you, that absolutely, so you write 1 by x, okay, integral 1 by x dx. I am not telling you what is a domain, okay. It will be not correct to write, you understand? I mean, for example,
x can be other than 0.
Yeah, wait, just one second, please. I want to say this. Let me, wait a bit. Suppose I write this, minus 1 to 1, 1 by x dx, okay? Then what do I get? Let us just blindly do this, okay? This will be, what's wrong with this? This is a type of thing you should never do. You have to split it, but near 0, the function 1 by x is not even integrable. You cannot integrate it. This is wrong. You have to, so when you write down a formula like this, integral 1 by x dx is equal to log mod x, pay careful attention. It is perfectly correct as written if you want to think of it as indefinite integral. But the moment you are dealing with definite integral, pay attention. 0 should not be anywhere there in the range of integration, in the interval of integration. If it is there, it's absurd, it's wrong. You cannot use this formula, okay? So that is, you have to pay attention to such finer details. It's important. It's not a matter of just mere convention. I want to discuss this.
So here 1 by x dx, log of minus x, as x is negative, limits because of that.
Yes, absolutely. So here, you see, well, I mean, when you write,
y equals minus x, and
you can do this. That's another suggestion from Professor Kesavan. You can put y is equal to minus x, and then the integral, the limits will change accordingly. They will now become positive. Then you will have log, so 1 by y dy, then that will become log y, and you can do it, and then also you will get the same answer. Okay? But important thing is, see, if you accept this formula, and I see nothing wrong with this formula as such, how should I view this formula? If x is negative, then 1 over x dx, when I integrate it, I get log minus x plus c. Okay? Now, this range of integration, that is from minus e to minus 1, I am in the negative side of the real axis. And therefore, when I integrate this, I should write log minus x. I should not write log x here. If I write log x, now what does it mean to write this? This means, or evaluate this. So you, see, mind you are going to put negative numbers here when you evaluate the limit. That doesn't make any sense. Okay? So that is why you have log minus x there. log minus x is the correct one. Which sign to choose is not optional. It is determined by the range, by the limits of the integration. Product of, so somebody has given this question. I don't fully understand, but I think I know where this question comes from. Then the person writes, so and then writes x minus root 2 y, no, root 2 times y is equal to 1, x plus root 2 times y is equal to 1, and then asks how. Well, from this step is okay, but this does not imply these two are 1, it could be 2 and this could be half, then also the product could be 1. So, without either of them being equal to 1, okay, or it could be minus 1 also. Perhaps this comes from some problem involving asymptotes. I'm a little surprised because asymptotes, see, if you put equal to 0, then individually these lines become 0, I mean these become straight lines, and that becomes actually the asymptote. Perhaps the question came from in an effort to understand asymptotes, I don't know. So, of course, so once this is the hyperbola, we all know it's a hyperbola. If this is a hyperbola, the asymptotes are given by this equating to 0, but this by themselves doesn't mean this individually they are equal to 1. Okay. I see. Okay.
But there he was dealing with integers.
Aha. Okay. Now that explains. Thanks. I missed most of the talks because I myself had to lecture at the same time here for my students. So I couldn't attend many talks. Oh, good. Okay. Yeah, now I want to take up this question about infinity and zero factorial and whatnot. There have been many questions asked. Somebody even points out, I'm very surprised and in fact pleasantly so, says that I said, I don't know, maybe one of the resource persons said that infinity is not a number. It says, oh, you said last time infinity is not a number, now you write this, and what does it mean? So I'm very happy somebody follows the lectures so closely and remembers that I said that infinity is not a number, and then maybe points out some contradiction. Really very impressed. Okay, so what is the explanation? Okay, I still maintain that infinity is not a number in the sense that infinity is, so the symbol, when we write like this, this is a symbol, okay? Okay, now, so when I say infinity is not a number, what I mean is, this is not an element of set of reals, okay? But nevertheless, we can use that symbol to express certain otherwise complicated statements, and to package them in a very compact way, okay? And I'll illustrate what I mean by means of examples, and perhaps this will help. And this notion of infinitude or infiniteness occurs, of course, throughout mathematics, and depending on the context, the symbol can mean different things. You even see it in real analysis or in calculus that you teach. Sometimes you write plus infinity and minus infinity. So sometimes you distinguish between these two. Sometimes you just simply write infinity. Sometimes you treat it like a number. I mean, so everything should be understood. This type of symbolism is best understood in the context, okay? And it also, which one to use, which in which context, That also will depend on what you are interested in. I will explain these statements by means of examples. Suppose you want to say limit x going to pi by 2 tan x. Okay. One can take the view that limit does not exist and be done with it. Limit does not exist because there is no, you know, there is a, you don't get a real number as an answer. But you want to capture the behavior of the function near pi by 2. So look at the graph. And you all know that how the graph looks like. So let me just recall for you. So I draw the graph. Pi by 2, and I find it convenient to draw this vertical line, and the graph looks something like this, and then like this, and goes like that, okay, something like that, and this is the line, maybe 3 pi by 2, I don't know. This is something like that, okay. So, some similar type of pattern this side also. You can just say, see that therefore, see as you go farther and farther away, you don't approach any definite point, therefore limit does not exist. That's a perfectly valid statement. And now, you can say, look, but you see, it becomes large and large and large, and goes off, becomes bigger and bigger and bigger indefinitely, okay, without approaching any finite number. And this behavior is expressed by saying limit x going to pi by 2 from the left side tan x is equal to plus infinity. It goes off to plus infinity, it becomes large and large and large as you approach, minus sign, as you approach pi by 2 from numbers, values below pi by 2. So you want to write like this. And now on the other side, it becomes negative, but in large magnitude, it approaches down, okay? And to express that, you may wish to write limit x goes to pi by 2. And as you say, since it happens, you want to capture the behavior as you approach towards this direction, that is values of x above pi by 2. So tan x, you may want to write this is equal to minus infinity, okay? Or you may be just simply not interested whether it goes to plus infinity or minus infinity, but it just goes far off in either direction, and you may package, and you may be a little bit imprecise and simply just say that, look, tan limit x going to pi by 2, tan x is equal to infinity. This is somewhat less precise than these two. Some people for that reason may say this does not exist. Only left side derivative exists, right side derivative exists, left limit, right limit exists, but this itself may not. But it all depends on your classroom convention. Generally, I think if somebody asks me, I will say this, both these are acceptable and this also is acceptable. All right. So, there are also situations where you may wish to say, for example, limit x goes to plus infinity, and I want to emphasize this, 1 by x is equal to 0. And what do we mean by that? Here, as x becomes large, okay, 1 by x becomes small and in fact approaches 0. Okay? And to express that, it's convenient to have this symbol. This whole thing should be thought of as just one sort of operation which reveals the behavior of the function near as you go towards, as you go far off to the right on the real line, okay? So, it is to be understood in that context. So, this is a symbol, and if you do not want to use this symbol pretending that infinity does not exist, as definitely infinity does not exist as a real number, that statement is still true, but that does not mean that I should not use take advantage of this symbolism. Okay? If you do not want to use that, you can express it in words and it will become half a page long. Okay? And you want to economize on your expression, because if you can economize on your expression, you can economize also on thought processes, and that will lead to better understanding. So by all means, you should use infinity as a symbol, and it's perfectly valid. Another notion of infinity which has to do with cardinality, I wonder if Pralay Sachar talked about that as well. Okay. So, and then there are several notions of infinity or infinitude. So, countable sets, I mean sets which are in bijection with natural numbers, and then I can get higher orders of infinity by looking at power sets of say natural numbers, and then power set of natural numbers, and so on. So then you are talking about something different. You are counting sets, counting a number of elements in a set, where you have to sort of extend your notion of what it means to count and what it means to say. So the notion of cardinality comes in. So that is of a different, there you have a certain, of course, you attach a certain meaning to the word infinity. It is perfectly correct to say this set is infinite. By that, all that you mean is this set is not of finite cardinality. It is not a finite set. To say a set is not finite, you just simply say the set is infinite. There you use the word infinite. Okay? So from in that context, you use it in a particular way. Here in particularly calculus, we use it to express behavior of certain function near a point. Okay? So it can be behavior as a function, the variable becomes indefinitely large, or it may be to capture something, behavior of some function looking like tan x near pi by 2.
Okay. So how do we define that, how do we represent the number line, real number line?
Yeah, real number line, we just draw a line like that, and we plot 0 and then at least 1, and now just say, okay, this represents a real line. No, okay, so you don't say infinity here. Okay, it's, in fact, somebody asked me this question. So what does it mean to say minus infinity phi? If you say that real infinity is not a real number, what does it mean to write like this? This simply means, by definition, this means set of all x in real numbers such that x is less than 5. That's what this means. Look at this side. This is a definition. And you symbolically write like that. And when you write, 2 comma plus infinity, what does it mean? This means x in real numbers. So infinity is not an element of, minus infinity is not an element in here. Minus infinity is not even a real number. How can it be an element of this set? I'm saying it's a subset of real numbers, right? Okay? But this, it is convenient to have a notation. It means all those which are less than 5. How do I denote it? If I want to say all those numbers between 1 and 20, I can write 1 comma 20. But if I want to say all those numbers below 20, how will I write it? I need a symbol for that. I write minus infinity to 20.
So for that case, it's the smallest to smaller number can take.
You should not. Okay, so you can, so again, depending on the context or situation, you may even want to introduce algebraic operations when infinity is involved. For example, you can say infinity plus 5, infinity, okay? But then you cannot associate meaning to minus infinity plus infinity. that is problematic.
So,
no, don't write here plus infinity, don't write here minus infinity, doesn't mean, no. Yeah, that is indicated usually by putting an arrow here. And in fact, this arrow,
they have minus infinity.
Forget about what books write. You know, books are also written by people like us. We may make mistakes. Okay, so don't take those things very seriously. You should tell your students infinity is not a real number. Infinity is a symbol. And it is used effectively. You have to use it to express certain complicated thought processes, certain complicated expression. Otherwise, you will have to write a page for what it requires, only two lines. You know, from that point of view, it is important to use that. Otherwise, no. Don't attach too much significance.
So for that, limit extending to minus infinity 1 by n.
Yeah. Here.
Now plus infinity is 0.
Yeah.
Because of the largest number.
Okay.
What will limit extending to minus infinity?
That also is 0. It becomes
negative.
Yeah.
Okay. Almost time, so I'll just take 1 minute and talk about the zero factorial. Again, you should, this is just a, I will say this is a convention that zero factorial is 1, but where does this convention come from? See, when we say convention, it's not enough. You have to sort of give some understanding where it comes from. It comes from binomial theorem, okay? So if you want to write a plus b over n, this is equal to binomial theorem tells you it is n choose k a power n minus k b power k, k goes from 0 to n. And then what is n choose k? N choose k, well, you can give this combinatorial interpretation, but ultimately this is n factorial by k factorial times n minus k factorial. And then the question arises, what if k equals 0? Okay? We would like this to be equal to 1 when k equals 0. And that forces 0 factorial to be 1. You would like it to be equal to 1. You know it is 1. The correct way to think of course, coefficient of a power n here on this side is 1. So this better be 1. If it has to be 1, what should be 0 factorial? If it has to be 1, so n factorial, by already I have n minus 0 factorial, which is n factorial, and this 0 factorial is still sticking out. So you would like to cancel that. Of course, you would like it to be 1. Therefore, 0 factorial you better be equal to 1. You convene that, and then consistently you notice that 0 factorial equal to 1 makes sense, and it fits into all the formulae where 0 factorial equal to 1, I mean, 0 factorial appears. That's it, be done with it. You can give your own explanation why 0 factorial should be equal to 1. To me, this is the most convincing, source why 0 factorial should be equal to 1. I think I'll stop here for now.